Penguin Random House Audio presents Coming Alive, four tools to defeat your inner enemy, ignite creative expression, and unleash your soul's potential, by Barry Michels and Phil Stutz. Read for you by the authors. To Judy White, who, like Daphne becoming the laurel, dared me to become the wind. Barry Michels, with help from Rainer Maria Rilke. For Andrew, who faced death as a boy and in the struggle became a man. Phil Stutz. To live is the rarest thing in the world. Most people exist. That is all. Oscar Wilde. Awake, arise, or be forever fallen. John Milton, Paradise Lost. Introduction. Most people suspect they could live a completely different life from the one they're now living. In this other life, their days are joyful. They're more confident. They take more risks. The things they do feel more meaningful. It's as if, in this alternate existence, they've plugged into a different kind of energy, an energy that makes anything seem possible. What they suspect is true. This energy is real, and it has the power to change lives. We call it the life force. It's the great prize of the universe, immortal, unstoppable, endlessly creative. Most of us have experienced the life force in some way. You may have felt it at the birth of a child. It might have emerged as an urge to play an instrument that you gave up on when you were younger. Maybe you were stuck on something you were writing, and then suddenly the solution came to you out of nowhere. Or perhaps you felt a dizzying grace when members of your family treated one another with love. There are an endless number of examples, each one reflecting the guiding, creating, infinitely nurturing qualities of the life force. The most significant use of the life force is that it allows each of us to put our stamp on the world, to give it something that is uniquely our own. It doesn't matter if it's something huge and public or something humble and private, as long as it's meaningful to you. When you use the life force in this way, you feel fully alive. But most of us get no more than a quick glimpse of this other life before a curtain drops and we lose touch with it, wondering if it ever really existed. We find ourselves back in tedious normal life, stripped of promise, focused on what we can't do, not on what we can. The source of our powerlessness, we believe, is some painful personal problem we are unable to overcome. It doesn't matter what the problem is. What matters is that you're unable to conquer it. Here are some of the ways our patients describe problems they've been unable to vanquish. Do any of these statements sound familiar to you? Do they apply to you or someone in your life? I can't control my thoughts. I scan my life looking for things to worry about. It's like I'm torturing myself. I feel like there's this in-group I can never be a part of. It's like there's something wrong with me. When I'm around people, my mind fills with negative thoughts about myself. I can't stand up to my boyfriend because I'm too afraid of losing him. On nights when I'm not with him, I drive past his house to make sure he's not out with someone else. I feel overwhelmed by the amount I have to get done, yet I sit in front of the TV like a zombie. I don't know what I'm waiting for. The world is unfair. People don't treat me the way I deserve. When my feelings are hurt, I don't get over it for days. The nature of the problem is different for each of these people, but they have one thing in common. Their problems seem insurmountable. Going to therapy and understanding the cause of the problem is no guarantee they can solve it. What we've found, after a combined 70 years of experience as practicing psychotherapists, is that understanding isn't the key to overcoming emotional problems. So what is? Hidden behind each problem is a force working to make sure you don't solve it. When you can't overcome an emotional problem, you feel powerless, and getting what you want from life feels impossible. This sense of impossibility keeps spreading, a poison in your soul. Eventually, you give up on expressing who you really are, on living the way you suspect you could. Being unable to solve your personal problems isn't an indicator of lack of potential. It's a sign that a powerful adversary is blocking your access to the life force. But concepts and theories won't give you access to the life force. You can't think yourself back to life. To free yourself, you need to feel the forces of life as they flow through you. So how do you access the life force? You need tools. Imagine a can of soup. If you want to know what the soup tastes like, reading the side of the can won't help. You need to actually taste it. Unless you have the hand strength of a superhero, this is impossible without a can opener. Think of this book as a can opener for your soul. It will give you the tools you need to access the life force and defeat your inner enemy. Only then will you discover what you're truly capable of and come alive in a way you never have before. Chapter 1: Reclaiming Your Life. Phil exposes the inner enemy that traps you in a limited existence and guides you through the first steps toward activating your full potential.
How I came alive. I became aware of the power of the life force as a college student, but it wasn't part of my coursework. At 17, I was already in my sophomore year. Physically and emotionally immature, I belonged back in high school. During my freshman year, I had indulged my greatest love, basketball. When I was 16 years old, I played on the best freshman team the school had had in years. Now I wanted to move up to the varsity. I wasn't ready. I needed to wait a year and get bigger and stronger. But I was a gym rat whose pulse would quicken at the sound of the bouncing ball. I made the team, barely, and then I got what I deserved. I spent the next 2 years riding the pine. The pine was the wooden bench the scrubs sat on during games. Worse than not playing was the dismissive way the coach treated the scrubs. By the time I was a senior, my confidence was destroyed. But what happened in that final season prepared me for the future in a way I never could have anticipated. The team was even better than when I was a freshman. The best player was an All-American point guard. I was his substitute, which meant I only played when he was injured or had fouled out, usually when the score was close and the crowd was going berserk. If I sat inertly watching, by the time I entered the game, I'd be so cold I could barely move. So I put myself in the game from the bench. I'd jump up and down, scream at the top of my lungs, yell out where the screens were, etc. Besides keeping me loose, it had an effect I didn't anticipate. It lifted up the energy of the guys actually playing. The best moments were when my excitement spread to the rest of the team. I learned that I can inspire others to do things they'd never done before. It was at those moments that I felt most alive. What I didn't realize at the time was that I was being prepared for my future. Recognizing the life force. Winning was great, but the most alive part of the experience, the part I still remember 50 years later, was feeling that inner fire grow. The more powerful the other team, the more difficult the challenge, the more inspired we became. The drive to experience this inspired state is what moves competitive athletes to train for hours every day. But sports are just one place to discover untapped potential. As a psychiatrist, my job isn't to win basketball games. It's to help people discover what they're capable of. This happens in obvious ways, like helping them get a better job, be a stronger leader, or break through a creative block. But our most important potentials aren't so obvious. To give and receive love, to listen to other people, to accept what life brings, to be patient. The spiritual and emotional abilities that work inside us and are the essence of what it means to be human. If you were building a fire, they would be the ring of stones that holds in the fire's heat, allowing the flames of inspiration to grow and connect you to what I came to call the life force. The life force speaks constantly, not in words, but through events. You can feel it as an undeniable presence guiding you. More commonly, You feel its presence for brief moments, usually in reaction to a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.